I'm here today with my friend Brett Jones in Franklin, Tennessee, just outside Nashville at his place. And Brett's been a songwriter in Nashville for 30 years or so.
Almost.
He's had hundreds of songs recorded. He's had, what, seven number ones?
Seven number ones.
And a bunch of top tens and just lots of songs on people's records. And he is a pro. He is a Jedi of songwriting.
I don't know about that.
Well, you've been
I'm
here a
still
long time.
Here.
Yeah.
I'm still kicking and scratching.
Yeah. Well, Nashville's a tough town, isn't it?
Yeah. You know, I was driving to work one day, and I just had this idea. You know, it's a crazy town. One day you're up, and the next day you're down. And I had written a little piece of it, and I took it into my buddy Ronnie Clausen, and we sat down and wrote the song. And it was, I had written songs with this kid named Jason Aldean, who actually got turned down 18 times by every major label.
18
twice,
times?
18 times. He
did, really?
He did 19 showcases and he got signed on his 19th showcase.
Wow.
So it's kind of channeled his story a little bit, and I may have subconsciously done that because I knew Jason and loved him, and I thought he was a great kid, and we'd written a handful of songs together, and he immediately picked it up and was going to record on his second album, but he didn't, and I'm glad he didn't because that album didn't do much, but he put it on his third album, and it was a big record on his third album, so
yeah.
it all worked out for both of us, you know. And it's kind of Jason's story, you know, in a nutshell. And
I
didn't really think about it, but I guess I kind of semi-consciously, you know, channeled him in writing the song. This is a song recorded by Jason Aldean. It's called Crazy Town. Are you rolling in the town? Step off the bus, shake off the way you came from, duh. Grab your guitar, walk down the street. In Nashville, Tennessee, but I have found a town full of neon dreams. Everybody plays, everybody sings. Hollywood with a touch of twang. Be a star, you gotta bang, bang, bang. Pin them string till the hang comes out. They call the drunk girls screaming, shouting, loving. Yeah, we're all just trying to make it in this
favorite songs that you ever written is Lee Ann Womack's song, Little Past Little Rock.
Thanks, man.
Where did that Where'd that song come from?
Well, actually, my song plugger was telling us a story. He said, I was a little past Little Rock, and I said, that's our song title we're writing today.
Yeah.
And we wrote it in about an hour and a half. But this song was a big number one for Lee Ann and I are friends now, and I played it at her 40th birthday party in Lincoln Bottom, Texas, so it was cool.
Oh, that's awesome. I love this song.
It's called Little Past Little Rock.
Favorite ones that you wrote was one by Tracy Lawrence.
Thanks, man.
Better Man, Better Off.
Yeah. I'm going to tell you how my first car contributed to my some of my biggest hits. So when I was in high school, I bought my first car. It was a 1936 Ford. I bought from an old black man for $150. It had been sitting out in the field for 20 years. It had a rusted out floorboard that needed a lot of work. So I took two jobs to fix it up, you know, to pay for fixing it up. and I worked on it in the barn while I was working these two jobs. And the two jobs were cutting pulpwood and fence posts and working the night shift on the weekends at a plywood factory. And I made $3.30 an hour. And I sold my fence post for 85 cents a piece, so it took a long time.
That's a lot.
Yeah, it took a long time to make enough money to pay for the parts I needed to fix this car up. And also, the most expensive part was getting the interior done in Columbus, Georgia, which is about 40 miles from my hometown. And I taken the car down there, and I almost had it saved up, you know, and finally I had the $700, and they got finished with the interior. I drove down to pick it up, and I was so proud. It was the end of the summer, and I handed my $700 cash, and I started driving back home in my pretty much brand-new-looking 1936 Ford. And everything was going great until we got about 10 miles from my hometown, and the distributor cap fell. And when the distributor cap goes out, you're dead in the water, so it just went... And my buddy who had taken me down there in a 1971 Ford Pinto... which they call Pinto bombs because they have a tendency to blow up.
Right.
Had a 40-foot logging cable in the back of his trunk, and so you know where this is going. We decided to tow it home.
Oh, no.
So we hooked this logging cable up to this 36 Ford, and we're going down the road. And we still got a good ways to go, you know, and he's going about, started out at 25, and hitched up to 30, and before I know it, it's 35, 40, 45, 50. Now all of a sudden he's going 55 miles an hour, and a 36 Ford is not even meant to go 55 miles an hour. And he just was listening to the radio, spaced out, I guess. And so I held my hand at the window, and I did like that for him to slow down. And when I did that, he hit the brake, and when he hit the brake, the cable wrapped around the front wheel.
Oh.
Flipped it seven times. Yeah, and the last thing I remember was holding myself on the door jam. And the pavement rushing by the window. That's before I woke up in the hospital.
Oh, man.
And I woke up in the hospital and survived. And they brought me pictures to see what the car looked like. And I wished I hadn't survived because it was just a wreck. And I was just heartbroken, you know.
After all those fence posts.
After all those fence
posts. All that pulpwood.
Oh, it was so terrible. That I never touched that car again other than to put it in my dad's barn. And it sat there gathering dust for 20 years. Fast forward to 1995, and I went down there with a friend of mine to do some chores for my mom. And he saw that old Ford sitting in the barn. He says, "Brett, you know that Telecaster I got you like so much?" He said, "I'll swap you even for this old car." And I said, "Done deal." And that guitar is this guitar.
Oh, man.
It's a 1970 Fender Telecaster.
Wow. Good trade, I'd say.
Yeah. And it's a collector's item. You know, it's worth probably $15,000. But the great thing about it is I wrote three of my number one records on this guitar. So that car, 20 years later, gave back a lot more than it took from me back in 1974.
Isn't that funny?
Yeah.
Isn't that funny how I've had a lot of stories with cars that affected my career? Indirectly.
Yeah, you have.
All right.
Still loving you, I'd do anything if you love me. Some things just ain't meant to be. Gonna be some pain, I gotta pay the cost, and in the long run be a better man, better off. This heartache, I know when the hurting stops, I'll be a better man, better off. I know wrong. left for the end. Gonna be some pain, I gotta pay the cost, and in the long run I'll be a better man, better off. Better man, better off. Yeah, I'm gonna learn from my mistakes. Once I'm past this heartache, I know when the hurting stops, I'll be a better man, better off. A whole lot better off. Yeah, a better man, better off. That I wrote on this guitar.